Tonight on Reel to Reel, we'll join Mayor Good and Cardinal Kroll as they greet the white voices of Avila.
And we'll meet Father Waylon Melton, an Episcopalian priest and father of four.
Mike Gallagher talks about movies for teenagers.
Father Tom Legere talks about relationships.
Youth Profile takes a second look at some very special young people.
And we'll take a minute to talk with former Philadelphian Cardinal John O'Connor.
Hello, I'm Isabel Gauvry LaGrosse.
And I'm Father Dave McAllen. Welcome to Reel to Reel. Big news in the church recently has been the elevation of 28 church leaders to the College of Cardinals by His Holiness John Paul II. Included in that group was former Philadelphian and current New Yorker John Cardinal O'Connor.
When the announcement was made, Cardinal O'Connor was in Philadelphia to speak at the kickoff dinner for this year's Catholic Charities Drive. We were honored to get a few minutes to speak with him about his new appointment.
It's an awe-inspiring thing to think that you could conceivably be called upon seriously to offer advice to our Holy Father in conjunction with the other cardinals, and that you have a special role in assisting the Holy Father in the overall governance of the Catholic Church that stretches all over the world.
At a crowded press conference in the Cathedral Rectory in Philadelphia, Cardinal O'Connor talked about his first reactions to his elevation.
I hope I'm no worse than I was spiritually 24 hours ago. One recognizes that if he has any humility at all or sense of office, he's going to have to pray harder, work harder, and remember that he becomes a bishop, an archbishop, a cardinal, only to minister to God's people all over the world.
Later, the cardinal spoke about the significance of a symbol in his new position.
I take very seriously the fact that a cardinal wears red. And red is a sign of blood. You know, I think that when one becomes a priest, one automatically intimately associates himself with the crucifixion, the continuation of the crucifixion in the Mass, the offering of one's body and blood to Almighty God as one offers the body and blood of Christ in the Mass. When you become a bishop, you recognize that that the potential for suffering is even greater, that greater sacrifices may be demanded.
Our whole reel-to-reel crew wishes Cardinal O'Connor the best as he prepares to receive his red hat.
Right now, we'd like to share a special story with you. There are plenty of people who are waiting to adopt children, and as we'll see in our next story, there are plenty of children waiting and wanting to be adopted.
You have lived such a gentle life upon this earth that I am stunned by your sight. If I could give but a token of the love you have, then I might not be this lonely tonight.
In our society, there is no problem at all finding homes for healthy white infants. However, there are children who exist who don't have homes and they're waiting for homes. These are older children, emotionally and physically handicapped kids, brother and sister groups, and black and biracial children of all ages.
Nancy Hoffheimer is the program director for a Cincinnati organization called SUMA.
SUMA stands for Services for Unmarried Parents and Specialized Adoptions. And we're a coalition of 22 member agencies in southwestern Ohio and northern Kentucky dealing in two specific program areas, special needs adoptions and problem pregnancy. What we do at SUMA is we try to find these homes for the children who are waiting. We do that primarily through the media. We do an extensive outreach program, campaigns such as Black Pride Means Loving a Black Child, Adopt One. We have a regular feature on WKRC television on the evening news each Thursday entitled Thursday's Child.
Tina knows this is just a temporary solution. She wants her own family.
What kind of a family do you want?
Black.
What else?
That's all.
Doesn't matter? No brothers and sisters?
Yeah.
What
kind? Three sisters and
that's a big family.
four boys.
That's a big family. You gonna let all those brothers and sisters boss you around? Okay. As long as you know what you're in for.
SUMA was the first agency in the country to have this sort of feature, and it's been picked up by other agencies. It's a very effective recruitment device. In fact, it's the most effective that we have. We are not a licensed adoption agency. We are a recruiting arm for the agencies in our community. So we do some pre-screening. We explain to them what the adoption process is, explain to them something about some of the children who are available, if they're available, if they're interested in a particular type of child, whether siblings or older or biracial or white or black, whatever. And if they are appropriate, we will then take an application on the children and send that application to the appropriate agency. There's a desperate need for adoptive parents. They have to be realistic. We are not looking for families for healthy white infants. But if they're interested in school-aged children, if they're interested in sibling groups, if they're interested in children who have an emotional or a physical handicap, the agencies in their community are interested in them.
One person who is helping SUMA promote the importance of special needs adoptions is Episcopalian priest Father Waylon Melton. A chaplain at Cincinnati's Children's Hospital, Father Melton has always loved working with children, especially teenagers.
I think children are gifts. And that as adults, whether they're our natural children or not, we are responsible for that gift. And if we have the space in our hearts, and we do, and in our homes, and we do, we should take care of those gifts. God's given them to us.
Although Father Melton is unmarried, he became so involved with SUMA's cause that he decided to adopt a special needs child himself. He completed the screening process at SUMA and was assigned to a social worker.
So she said, I think you ought to look at a family group. Oh, goodness. No, just two boys that I'd like for you to look at, because we don't really want to separate them because they're so interdependent. And I don't think one will really survive without the other. And so I said, okay, after some convincing and lots of reading and meeting them.
James, who is now 13, and Antonio, who is 10, officially became Melton's 4.5 years ago. 6 months after the adoption was finalized, the social worker asked permission to tell the boys that they had a new baby sister. Jennifer had been born to their mother 6 months before. She was a fetal alcoholic and not expected to live. When Father Melton told the boys about their critically ill sister, James only wanted one thing, to bring her into their home so she could die with her family.
So I talked to the social worker about adopting this baby girl, and she said, there's no way they're going to let a single man adopt a baby girl in this county. I went, oh? And being the person I am, I said, let's try it. So we did, and I think, and it was successful, probably because she was a special needs child.
Thanks to the love and concern of her family, Jennifer is now a very happy little 4-year-old. James and Antonio's 15-year-old sister, Tricia, had spent many years living in an orphanage. She began visiting them on weekends and one day asked Father Melton if he would adopt her also. After a year of waiting, the adoption was finalized, and she, too, became a member of the Melton family.
They've learned to love and care about each other, that they feel for each other when they're not there. And for me, that's the beginning of community, and that's the beginning of family, and that's what church and religion is all about. New Testament says we are a part of God's family anyway, by adoption. So why not say, come on in, you know, you're a part of this, you are related to me. And our bloodlines go deeper than the color of our blood and the chromosome buildup, but into our baptism and our faithfulness. To see these children come from hard little children who can't love, who find it hard to love, to being loving is new birth, is resurrection. And I think that's what's exciting. And people ought to participate in that. Foster care, adopt. That will make the Easter story something that is so alive and that can be experienced part of it anyway on Earth. I would say, don't miss it.
Did you know that love can grow any place where people go? And I can tell by what I see that you have found a place with me. The sun is high, the day is new, and I have found a place with you.
We're going to take a break, but when we come back, we'll have Mike Gallagher and Father Tom Legere.
And we're going to update the stories of some very special young people on this month's Youth Profile. So stay with us.
Hello, I'm Mike Gallagher. The bad news about the current crop of movies aimed at teenagers is self-evident. Movies like The Simple-Minded Mischief just about comply with the exacting standards of softcore pornography. And then there's Porky's Revenge. The old gang at Angel Beach High now looks old enough to be out of graduate school, but they haven't changed one bit. It's a vulgar, sexually exploitative movie that's beneath contempt. Now, The Breakfast Club, on the other hand, is a skillfully made, extremely well-acted film. But I'm afraid it's still part of the bad news, and I'm really sorry about those howls of anguish. I know you teenagers just love it. It's this. Five teenagers from an affluent suburb spend Saturday in detention in the school library. All are white. Apparently, the minority groups at this high school are very well behaved. At any rate, the kids are quite different otherwise. A prom queen, a nerd genius, a teenage bag lady, a loudmouth thug, and an athlete. After much abrasive interchange and a little marijuana, they become downright chummy, however, especially when they realize what they have in common. If they're messed up, and they are messed up, they're not to blame. Mom and Dad are to blame. Now, I'm quite sure that kids like this need love and attention just as much as any inner-city kids. I have no quarrel about that. Look at the suicides in Westchester. What they don't need, however, is being told that drugs are liberating and casual sex is the best way to prove you're not a tease. And what they don't need above everything else is being pandered to, and I think The Breakfast Club does just that. Now, the sure thing. Two college freshmen, John Cusick and Daphne Zuniga, find themselves thrown together in the course of a cross-country trip. They're not strangers, they've already gotten to know each other all too well, enough for her to just loathe him. They're on their way to California for quite diverse reasons in keeping with their quite diverse natures. He, immature and glandular, has been promised a sure thing, a blonde, cheerfully promiscuous surfer girl. She's going to join a yuppie fiancé who, like her, is excruciatingly organized and impeccably programmed for success. Needless to say, in the great movie tradition of It Happened One Night, the trip changes everything. Now, this movie is about romance, not sex, which is enough to distance it from all those other teenage movies. Cusack and Miss Aniga are appealing, even if I, for one, thought his initial stand-up comic overtures were just a little too much. Nonetheless, The Sure Thing is a pleasant enough movie in its message that teenagers just might possibly have some maturing left to do, and that sex is not the end-all and the be-all of existence is surely a welcome one. I'm Mike Gallagher for Arts Review.
I always enjoy Mike Gallagher. I'm glad he's a regular segment.
One of my favorite features, which was new this year, is our Youth Profile series. All of us here at Reel to Reel are particularly proud of this series, and as you watch this retrospective and update, you'll see why.
Jesus loves the little children of the world.
The children of the world were the recipients of this message from Pope John Paul II. You young people are the ones who embody this youth. You are the youth of the nations and societies, the youth of every family and of all humanity. You are also the youth of the Church. The Holy Father was speaking to the youth of the world in recognition of the United Nations International Youth Year. We at Reel to Reel also wish to acknowledge International Youth Year, and so this season we established a new feature for our program, Youth Profile. We have met several outstanding young people from the Delaware Valley. Young people like Chris Hilden. Chris refuses to let his visual handicap prevent him from being a competitive bowler. And now, Chris is a member of Cardinal O'Hara's intramural basketball team, believe it or not, as Chris would say. Many of our viewers wrote in to comment on the story of Joe Angelo, who was in foster care since birth.
I felt cheated, but I'm not going to sit back and say, oh God, I've been cheated, I can never grow, and I'll never be anything. I have some very high standards I've set for myself, and I hope and I know I will get there.
Joe's great enthusiasm for life was very evident, and when we last spoke with him, Joe told us that he plans to attend the summer session at Drexel University. As he put it, no vacations until I retire. We had the chance to catch a rising star when we met Chrissy Frelick, a very talented 12-year-old actress and singer. Since our story first aired, Chrissy has appeared in productions of Tom Sawyer and Alice in Wonderland. Reel to Reel has been privileged to introduce these and other outstanding young people to our audiences. And now, we'd like to ask you to introduce us to some young person whom you may know that would be a candidate for our Youth Profile series. Send your suggestions for Youth Profile to producer Judy Moran, 222 North 17th Street, room 907, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, 19103.
And now, waiting in the wings is Father Tom Legere with tonight's relationships.
Greetings in the Lord. One of the subtlest forms of self-hate is to demand perfection from ourselves. It is subtle because it may look very spiritual and noble. Actually, it is nothing more than an exercise in self-rejection. When we set up impossible godlike standards for ourselves, we are setting ourselves up for a colossal crash. It is a no-win situation in which we are virtually programming ourselves for anxiety, depression, and fatigue. The sickness of perfectionism is something that frequently goes back to childhood. Many individuals had rigid, demanding parents who doled out their love only on the condition that their child attain perfection. Because this never happened, the parents' praise was always conditioned with, next time, try to do a little better. Comedian Sam Levinson tells a story that his father was never satisfied with the grades he earned in school. One day, young Sam proudly brought home a test on which he received a grade of 95. His father's comment was, "Who got the other 5 points?" One of the best schools of self-acceptance is, oddly enough, organized sports. When you compete in any organized sport, you soon learn that any accomplishment is something that is relative. A 300 hitter in baseball is considered a blue chip player, but a 300 hitter fails 7 times out of 10. A 50% shooter in basketball is an all-star, but a 50% shooter misses half his shots. Babe Ruth hit 714 home runs in his career, but he also struck out 1,400 times. He struck out twice as often as he hit a home run, but we look at his overall record and conclude that he did very well. People in all walks of life need to recognize their human limitations. Sometimes you succeed and sometimes you do not. I know that I myself have never given the perfect homily at Mass, but nevertheless, I try my best and put the results in the hands of God. It is not a sin to fail at something, but for those infected with the sickness of perfectionism, any kind of failure is always taken as a personal tragedy. Those with a healthy self-image, on the other hand, will praise God when they succeed and have a healthy laugh at themselves when they fail. Perfectionists need our help. If we can ever bring them the freeing, unconditional love of God, then perhaps they will finally learn to accept themselves as the beautiful persons that they really are.
If you'd like a copy of Father Legere's message, please send us a note here at Reel to Reel, and we'll be happy to send you one.
We're going to break away now, but when we return, we'll introduce you to a group of visitors to Philadelphia known as Las Vocas Blancas de Ávila.
When we were in Rome recently, I was amazed by the quizzical look of the Italians when I mentioned I was from Philadelphia. But if I mentioned New York or Los Angeles, their eyes would light up with interest.
Well, Philadelphia might not be a must-see for most Europeans, but for this next group of teens, the city of brotherly love was the place to be. This was the scene a little over a year ago at a small Catholic church in the Kensington section of Philadelphia. St. Boniface Church made local history when their choir traveled to the small town of Ávila, Spain, on the first leg of a cultural exchange with a Spanish choir known as Las Vocas Blancas de Ávila.
This first came about 2 years ago in the summer of 1983 when I was on vacation alone in Spain, and I bumped into this group in Santiago de Compostela. They had invited us to come over the following year, which we did, which was April of 84.
Tom Winfelder is the director of the St. Boniface School Choir.
Some of the highlights of the trip were our visit to the places of interest of St. Teresa of Ávila. She was all over Spain, and she was really the one that reformed Spain, liturgically speaking. I think socially the highlight was just the people of Ávila themselves. We became friends, we became family. And musically, the highlight was the Children's Choral Festival, which was held during Holy Week in Spain.
A few days after Easter of 1984, St. Boniface Choir returned to America with fond memories of their newfound European friends. Although the departure was emotional, both choirs knew they would be reunited for the second part of this unique cultural exchange when Las Vocas Blancas de Ávila, or the White Voices, came to America.
They almost didn't make it to America, and several times we thought the trip would be canceled. There's just so much red tape when you're transporting a group and when you are the one supplying the airline tickets. When the two choirs first met, well, we couldn't afford to take all of our children to New York. So most of the people were waiting at St. Boniface Church, and it wasn't just the children, it was their parents, it was people from the community, and they got a reception. When that bus turned the corner, they gave them a reception like an Olympic team returning from a victory.
It was more than a vacation for these 36 young Spaniards. It was an exchange of cultures, lifestyles, thoughts, ideas, and most importantly, music. Severano Jimenez Blasquez is the director of the White Voices of Ávila, and we asked him about the differences between Ávila and Philadelphia.
It's una cultura totalmente diferente.
He likes Philadelphia because it's such a large city. It's so different from where he lives. There's so many things that are so different. Everything is on a much larger scale, and he likes it very much. In 10 minutes, you can cross the entire town of Ávila. Here, it's different. There are so many different lifestyles. Everything is different, the way you think about things, your point of view, the way that people think, the way they see, the atmosphere in the air.
And over the course of their 12-day stay, our Spanish visitors received a healthy dose of American lifestyle and hospitality with free trips to the museums and historic sites that make Philadelphia the city of brotherly love. And the White Voices repaid the city many times over by raising their voices in song at neighborhood churches during Easter week, including this performance at the youth rally held on Palm Sunday at St. Peter and Paul Cathedral.
Háblame del hombre, háblame de Dios, háblame de Dios.
hablarte del mundo, hablarte de paz.
After the youth rally, the white voices were received by His Eminence John Cardinal Kroll to express international greetings, take a few snapshots, and give the gift of song.
Ávila tiene la fama, Ávila tiene la fama, del vino y del aguardiente, de las mujeres bonitas y de los hombres valientes.
Both choirs were greeted by Philadelphia Mayor Wilson Good in a special ceremony at City Hall.
I want to especially to welcome the White Voices Choir from Spain here to our city, Philadelphia.
After mementos of their visit were distributed, both choirs showed their thanks to the mayor and the city of Philadelphia with a song. White voices have returned to Avila with memories to last a lifetime from the city of brotherly love.
That was just great. I could listen to those kids all night.
Me too. Earlier this evening, we said that Cardinal John O'Connor was in town to kick off the annual Catholic Charities appeal.
And we just want to remind you that beginning today and for the next 2 weeks, your fellow parishioners will be coming around for your contributions. Please be generous.
Next week on Reel to Reel, we'll have a special show for that one woman in all of our lives, Mom.
We'll meet mother, writer, and career woman, Evelie Griffin.
And we'll talk to Monsignor Charles McGrawardy of the Philadelphia Family Life Center to find out why no mom is an island. Father John Scarcia will join us on the lighter side.
And Rosemary Bruno will be along with In the Know.
Be sure to send your comments to Reel, 222 North 17th Street, room 907, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, 19103. Good night.
Good night. And remember, Jesus is Lord.